evening. Welcome back to our spring lecture series. It's a great pleasure this evening to be able to welcome Iñaki Ábalos to UIC, and also with regret that I have to announce that unfortunately Iñaki's co-principal, Renata Sentkiewicz, was not able to join us tonight, but we look forward to having her here in the future. So we will have just Iñaki. Iñaki received his architectural education as well as his PhD from the ETSA in Madrid, where he is also currently a chair professor and director of the Laboratory for Contemporary Techniques and Landscapes. For the past 3 years, Iñaki has also been a visiting professor at Harvard's GSD. He's here with students from GSD today, the working on Chicago. And before that, Iñaki also taught at Cornell, Princeton, Columbia, Harvard, the AA, and Hussein. Iñaki was the co-principal and co-founder of Ábalos+Sentkiewicz Architects from 1984 to 2006, and since then has been co-principal at Ábalos+Sentkiewicz. In addition to teaching and practice, Iñaki is also a member of the research board of the CCA in Montreal, and the author of several books, including his influential book, co-authored with Juan Herrera's Tower and Office. It's probably out of that research and that book that Iñaki is a longtime fan of Chicago and its work, including some figures in our archive that need to be more widely known, thanks to some of our faculty in college, like Bob Bruton and others. They are becoming more well-known, but Iñaki is a big fan of Weiss and Goldberg and others. And from Chicago's point of view, if I can speak for Chicago, we reciprocally like and are fans of Iñaki's work. So the admiration is reciprocal. Iñaki is also the author of a book called The Good Life, which should recommend him to us immediately. It's about a kind of a guide of seven, a tour of seven hypothetical houses enabled by modernity. So it's looking at modernism and modern architecture, not from the point of view of its masterpieces per se, but really from the sets of possibilities and protocols that modernism provides in order to produce the good life. And I think in a certain sense, our attempt also to unpack modernism and extend its possibilities today has great sympathy also with Iñaki's work. It's hard to introduce Iñaki. I've known him for a while. We don't see each other that often. In fact, I have to say the last time we saw each other was not such a great experience. And so I appreciate his bravery of coming back, which is the last time we were at OSU together. I was driving around and we had a bit of a traffic incident. So I can also say that Iñaki is a great witness. If you need any witnesses for accidents, Iñaki is very good. I don't see anything. He's perfectly in the right. And then send the police to Spain to track him down to get the statement. That was all cleared up, by the way. And also, I will assure you that we're taking CTA tonight. Also, Iñaki is one of those rare people in architecture that you meet where when you see him, you just smile and laugh. There's very few people in the field that one likes to see as often as Iñaki. And maybe the other rare aspect is precisely this combination of being still a practitioner of great design projects, but also a teacher and also a writer and researcher. And that is a combination that also these days is too rare, about how one situates a project in architecture and then also delivers on it. In general, and you can see from both the work and Iñaki's laboratory in Madrid, which is engaged both with building techniques and technologies as well as larger urban and landscape systems. But it's an interest in both kind of micro architecture at the level of technology and macro at the level of landscape and urbanism that never loses its focus on the presumptive product, you could say, of architecture as the scale at which those things have to become visible and indeed deliver projects with great graphic boldness, I would say. So it's a great pleasure to have Iñaki with us, so please welcome Iñaki Ábalos.
Thank you, Bob, for this wonderful presentation. Thank you, everyone, for being here, and all the people that are participating in the I have not written work. And this is what I want to speak about. The format is completely commercial. Projects and works. And I have called it the thermodynamic building because from the moment that we began to work as Ábalos+Sentkiewicz Arquitectos, we wanted to bring a kind of more, we had been previously in Ábalos and Herreros driving things in a kind of crazy way, you know? So in a very opportunistic way, competitions, whatever came, and we were like bullfighters waiting for the bull, and depending on the violence, when this side, the other side. And so we wanted to establish a kind of order. And one of the topics we wanted to focus on, and we've been discussing at the office, at the laboratorio, in the school, etc., is this horrible topic of sustainability, how to deal with it. And one of the, horrible in the sense that it has become a completely rhetorical issue. But we think that it's a serious issue, and it has a technical and it has an architectural or conceptual implications. And one of the ways we approach it has been through imagining the primitive heart of sustainability, you know, and trying to understand how this issue of sustainability can be linked with more historical or more, I would say, architectural issues instead of just technical and arrows, you know, this kind of blue and red arrow going up and down, as it says it, right? And this guy starting this bucky plastic dome, and this beautiful drawing of one of our masters, in this case Alejandro de la Sota, in one way or another exemplified for us the two different primitive parts of two different planets. Obviously, the primitive heart of sustainability has to deal with climatic conditions. And so, if one belongs to the geography of cold weather, like Chicago, and it's protective and is able to produce a kind of capsule that separates the interior and exterior and has its technological tradition, the one that belongs to the same Mediterranean, tropical climate is much more open. It's made of shadows, it's made of a close interaction with nature, it's made of wind passing through the shadow, and etc. And this house, you don't see anything about this house except the effects, the climatic effects, that you can perceive some kind of sensorial pleasure. Just looking at these people sat there in their sofas. This other primitive heart, as I was saying, has a deep, narrow relationship with landscape. So with using landscape as a material of construction. So when Bob has talked about techniques and technologies and also landscape issues, I think that what for us is interesting is that these two primitive hearts are exemplifying in many ways the main two changes that academia had in these last decades, you know, the introduction of physics and a kind of new understanding of thermodynamic condition for architecture in one way. So let's call it the scientific brain, helped by parametric programs, etc. And then in the other way, the emergency of landscape issues in magazines and discussions and collaboration with architects, which belongs to another tradition that was invented in Harvard at the beginning of the 19th century, so all of you know. And for us, it's not a question of choosing which one is good or bad, or as we work in a kind of subtropical climate, we should go for this or should. I think that the most interesting thing is to be able to deal with both, to operate with both in a kind of global condition, and being able to establish a kind of differentiation and articulation depending on the specific conditions of the projects, on which level, which doses of one and the other primitive matter.
and being incorporated.
Said that, well, this is the subtropical planet, and said that, I have bring a couple of topics. One is the notion of vertical scales that the students are dealing with as an alternative to the tradition of the skyscraper, as a meeting point of architecture, landscape, and environmental techniques, as I was saying. A kind of introducing public dimension in contrast to the tradition of the high rise, and stabilizing programmatic and technical hybrids in order to establish great, like, rings of interchange that are not purely commercial, that are at the same time social and technical in terms of energy and interchanges. Well, I don't want to go too much into this because I can stand like 10 minutes. But we are interested, we have been obviously interested in the tradition of Chicago, the tradition of the skyscraper. We think that this tradition has begun to grow. It's a typology that has only 120 years. It's really just a child. And a lot of things can be incorporated, discussed, experimented in relationship with the transformation of this typology. The other one is the topic of the, when we talk about thermodynamic beauty, we talk about the Second World beauty. I think that we try not to lose the focus on beauty, which is a word that everyone begins to be scared when I talk about it. It's the House of Muses, and more than the House of Muses, it seems to me that it's a battle of muses, but we still think that even if museums are almost finished, in the first world, we think that the idea of how the House of Muses can be nowadays has to pass through three different considerations. One is the understanding of the House of Muses as a center of production instead of just a kind of passive, contemplative relationship with the world of art. We think it's an active, productive factory. There is a second one, which is that, yes, very pragmatic, that probably the only thing we can do with museums right now is to incorporate environmental issues to the need that every 30 years, more or less, every museum has, and try to reconsider a lot of things, like natural light inside, or the way environmental issues can change the way we perceive and use and experiment art. And then the idea, again, of the vertical escape, the idea of having more potential spatial relationships with landscape, city, etc., through the introduction of verticality. But I just put these things on the table. To do all these things, we use a kind of different geometries. I think geometry is the tool, the main tool to design and to relate natural, environmental, and architectural issues. We need a translator of these three words, and the translator is usually the geometry, but it's always dealing with ideas of nature, you will see why we have tried to establish a kind of these horrible names, transcendental abstraction, and meaningless romantic and post-mystic. But they have a close relationship with the use of different geometries. The first one is just obvious. We have forgotten many times that the main access to nature that human beings have is elemental, in the sense that it's taking possession of them, transforming into the simple geometries what we see, what we perceive as a chaotic presence. And it's closely related with the scientific understanding of the internal structure of this chaotic perception we have of nature. So in one way or another, simplicity is implicit to the first and to the last approach, and we try to maintain a relationship with geometry that establishes this kind of links using very simple geometries in front of you, not to become exclusively mimetic in this relationship. This is a very simple project that I will begin with. It's a museum, a CAIXA forum in Spain, in a very hardy climate in a desert area of Spain. And it was, for us it was an experiment, a little mission, and for us it was an experiment. And how could we really try to develop the idea of a thermodynamic emission? How could we move people and flows of energy in the same way, producing one, produce the other? And so it passes through a very diagrammatic. The site is just terrible. Every contemporary site is something like this, a kind of new I plus D area full of rhetorics and geometries like this, that, horrible buildings. One of these was, I think it was this one, the one that occupies the site. So we decided to go to worry exclusively about the internal relationships, not to worry about the pre-existing conditions. This is the, is in Spanish? Sorry, what everyone understands. Sistemas activos is active systems, and so on. It's not difficult. It's a couple of triangles, a wonderful synthesis of environmental issues made by Stefan Bell. I can say wonderful because it's not mine. and that says what we have been doing, all architects and engineers, and what should be done if we want really to transform this issue into something more natural and more efficient, giving much more weight to the form in architecture. So the way, the volume, the way the physical conditions of the object relate with the climatic conditions. Passive systems for construction systems, and then externally, when the rest doesn't work, active or high-tech, let's say, system. It's very simple, but it's very efficient to establish a kind of taxonomy of sustainability. So we began with form, and we went in the climate, in a very arid and deserted climate of Zaragoza. We began to work with some experts in order to minimize the interchanges. It's not a cubic form, it's more the form to reduce its west orientation and roof, so it's among a cube and I don't know the name in English, another geometrical form. And then something is underground, so the combination, it reduces instantly the interchanges dramatically. Then we establish in this volume a kind of helix around the internal core, very simple shape. I will explain later. I'm not going to. The program is, as in every museum, a couple of big rooms, a cafeteria, a shop, a little auditorium, offices, etc. This is the second step, reducing as much as possible the interchanges through reducing the windows, basically. And creating a kind of facade made of concrete, which is structural at the same time, and then protecting this facade with a kind of envelope of lattices creating shadow, so that the whole issue of this facade was creating a kind of shadow that protects the massive construction in concrete section. Modern. Here you will begin to see. I mean, it was obviously it's not that arid the process. We knew, I mean, a little museum is a very opaque form and should, in one way or another, be able to breathe and to give some image. And for us, it was not exclusively technical. The main issue was about giving sort of. Being able to discover a language that could transmit the idea that this was a kind of thermodynamical approach to the idea of a museum. And this was a sketch, handmade. We still make this old fashioned thing, handmade sketches. And so it's a kind of shape of shadows and lattices of ceramic. And this was the conceptual agreement of what we were pretending. Some terraces in the roof were able to split the concrete and the lattices, creating again the final space for the vertical community, and creating also protection for the radiation to the roof, which is the biggest amount of negative radiation. I'm not going into this, I promise. We use geothermal, it's perfect for this kind of program, and believe me, all these facts are serious. And combined for the auditorium and for the rest, and also solar, other photovoltaic at the top. But the thing is that we are connecting and resuming more architectural terms in the inertia of the ground with the activity of the sand on the top, and creating a kind of balance among these two things. What more steam, summer and winter, you know, the sun goes up and down. And then establishing a kind of third element, which is this phase change material, which creates a bank of calories or frequencies, so it's a bank of energy that establishes a kind of equilibrium among what you have established and what you have received from the sun, changing the phase of the material, designing the temperature of the change of phase, and then using the dissipation of energy to produce electricity and to feed the building. This is schematically, I hope you have understood my body in this scheme. And if not, believe that it's serious, and there are a lot of experiments in this sense. But I think that the most interesting thing was that establishing this change of this verticality in the way we were managing energy, and establishing it, the distribution of this thing through the core, internal core, we were replicating the movement of people, and we were creating a very simple but first prototype of what could be understood as a, let's say, potentially a thermodynamic motion. What is an experiment, and I don't want to go much more. With people. And this is this is the only image we have. It's a white terracotta, so it creates these effects, filters that change the day, etc. Another use of this simple geometry, and very simple thermodynamic principles in this spirit in Madrid, is this little thing very close to the donut. The donut is the British Embassy. This is a palace of the 19th century, and the house for horses, I don't know how you call it in English, was an abandoned structure that had to be demolished, and in this little area we could propose some houses for ambassadors and workers of embassies, because this is the neighborhood where they live. Very interesting. In terms of environmental terms, in terms of also the landscape, is a very interesting neighborhood of Madrid. And this is the proposal we came finally to build. It's a kind of reinterpretation of the only, I would say, thermodynamic invention that residential houses in Madrid have developed 200 years ago, which is what we call the mirador, a double glass facade that really can be open or closed, and it favors the relationship with exterior in those moments of the year that the temperature is equilibrated, and protects in summer and winter in a very similar way. For us was an excuse, I must confess, it was an excuse to be approved by the Commission of Patrimonio, which if you draw a single window, you are condemned to replicate the historical motifs and so on. So we went for this kind of other way to work with glass and cast iron, etc., and produce this thing that is very cubical, very simple, and at the same time the section is being excavated to obtain as it lifts up, if it goes up, so you have like terraces on the two different sides. And then you have these little pieces of land protecting from the sun, and the tree, which is our wonderful tree at in the east orientation that belongs to the palace. And so there is a combination of the only, I would say, natural landscape mean that we had with some other means we had, like natural ventilation. These are these fences that you see are protecting windows that operate and are open, introducing natural wind in the houses. I have to say that compared to the regime of winds of Madrid is higher than the regime of winds of Chicago, even if you don't believe me. And it's the main tool we have to balance the comfort, because I mean the temperatures are different. But it's a continuous regime, and every night in summer we have 4 or 5 hours of very freezing wind that reset the buildings. So to have a very compact shape, to have a patio, and to have this kind of big windows that allow for this, reduces the need of air conditioning to 1, 2, 3 nights a year. But in this case, I mean, the whole idea was about establishing a good relationship with the neighborhood, not in terms of amenities, but in terms of abstraction, and trying to establish a kind of reconsideration of traditional typologies seen from another point of view. This is the under construction almost finished. We could, I mean, this is opaque window that reflects the light, so, because of legal reasons, the whole idea is to establish a kind of pavilion that in one way or another establishes a relationship with the palace, but at the same time is completely autonomous in its materiality, its compositional, and its formal, typological, thermodynamical behavior. It has this ornament to protect, you know, when you open the window, which for us was completely needed, and to first of all to be approved, and second to give a kind of elegant dimension to this construction that was completely needed because of the standards of the neighborhood, and also because we like it. But this is like the most generic. I mean, I have been all my life when telephones were not iPhones, when were fixed machines, drawing, talking with Bob or whatever, drawing this thing. It's a kind of obsession. It's like the most generic and abstract ornament you can ever imagine, present in every culture. Well, this is the relationship with the street. And you see here that it's a very, very, in one way, it's a very traditional. With this kind of rooms, one after the other, making a kind of corner. And you have very simple things. To the south, the main rooms of the house, to the north, the dormitory, the bedrooms, and in the middle, some stuff connecting through the patio and trying to establish a kind of generic condition with generous dimensions in mostly all the rooms. And terraces that are making a set back in every part, a different floor, creating a kind of open air room that is really enjoyable in the climate of Madrid. This is the relationship. But wonderful details. Well, this is the palette, so to say. The glass is protected by these pieces of lead. It's east, north, and south, so the west is completely protected. And this is the kind of terraces that are obtained simply making these symbols. Ground floor. And the other thing is how the entrance to the house that has its bourgeois protocols, you know, the stone, the mirror, whatever, you know, the high class thing. We played with all this, but tried to make something different. because the whole plot was really narrow and small. We wanted to give a kind of third dimension and give a kind of generosity to the entrance. And this drove us to change the traditional position of murals, but created a kind of kaleidoscopic effect. It's black stone, black granite. Simple details, more simple construction systems in the interior, contrasting the steel, stone, and so on. And the complex program of the window, this and this. It's very simple, but works quite well, and it's a beautiful relationship with the steel. And the effects, I mean, a lot of effects on nature and environment in relationship with shadows and sun. So we have this and this continuously changing. The tree in summer. And the structure is trying to force the idea that this is not a kind of typical apartment wall, or it's not, it's like a hybrid. This is the real structure of the building. The center is it's concrete core, but the facade is a kind of fabric of big stones, and it works to sustain the glass as if it were a kind of transparent stone. And continuity established. So we wanted to produce a space that could be used in at the same time for families or groups of that really have another culture, or those that are completely traditional and without feeling strangers to this space. And this was the point. This is not, I am not going to do it more. Third project. We go to Paris. Grand Paris. To the Grand Paris. They are dealing in Paris now with a lot of issues. I don't know what's going to happen. But one is to link all the suburbs that are administratively and also physically separated into a kind of great ring made of underground stations. So and use this infrastructure to produce new centralities. So we were asked to propose a couple of things to the offices, to propose different prototypes of what this new station, underground station in Paris, would mean in, as a political but also as a urban tool. And we tried to be always very simple. This is the panel of a station, and what we said that was completely needed was to give a physical presence to this infrastructure, to make it visible. So the best, more simple thing we could try to do is to transform it into a kind of vertical structure that wraps or is wrapped by a conventional building. This explains it quite well. And this is what we have. We were working with Jasper Morrison because we wanted to maintain a kind of memory of the conventionality of the Paris station, and no one like Jasper Morrison was able to deal with these issues of memory in an identity. And this is what we produce, and kind of also using ceramics and some things that immediately remind to the Paris stations, but as new technologies provide us to encapsulate the metro itself, the whole air that you can breathe changes the noise and the smell changes completely, and it begins, it will immediately begin to be more like I would say an airport space and a metro station, so it will be clean. So we wanted to introduce natural light in this system to complete, you know, the transformation of the atmosphere of our station. And what, well, these are details. The idea is basically this one, this is the volume, the wrapped in the tides of thermal, new tides, very low tides. Creating this kind of transition from horizontal to vertical, and establishing a kind of helix that gives way into a direct contact with the steel. Well, then there are issues related with creating a public plaza with a lot lot of activity. French people always want a lot of activity in their living. So you have to spend a lot of time growing informal markets, I think. Pop music conference, sometimes. As if you were able to design. But anyway, yeah, at the ground level, you have an intermodal station, so you have public buses, bikes, etc. And this was, this is more important. We admire a lot this David and Jay building in London, which changed drastically the idea bookstore. The public collective dimension of the neighborhood, and we just have added some spaces to be sold or rented to create the investment. And we used the whole iconography of the other project I have shown in Madrid to make it. And this is what we were proposing, twin tower or very conventional scheme, wrapped in this thing, with sunken car parks, electrical, public electrical car parks that you pay with your Visa card, connected with the metro, so you reduce all this stuff, CO2, etc. And a mix of buildings. The more interesting thing is that what we have tried to deal is to create a vertical structure with a complex program that transforms the energy of the air embedded in the metro infrastructure into a mean to equilibrate the demands of energy for the different programs. Let me go very quick, so we don't get too bored. Connection with two lines, people in the street, more people in the street, more conflicts. And this is the whole idea is to create a combination of cultural facilities, public facilities, office for young people, need for young initiatives, etc., and apartments, lofts, etc., combining, creating a unique entity that is made basically of the same kind of materiality. So we could show that it had a physical, immediate response, so it's not an invention, so it can be made with the same materials. And also using heliostats to introduce the hours that the metro is used more intensively to introduce natural light. This is why the shape of the towers is cut in this way to allow for this introduction. And giving this is what you don't see anything. This is the idea. So the proportion of uses that are 24 hours in use, or those that are exclusively 8, and those that produce and those that demand energy has been combined more or less scientifically. I mean, it's not our duty, but we were helped by very good experts to produce an entity that is really self-sufficient using the energy of the metro infrastructure, the public infrastructure. So this is a kind of prototype that probably makes sense to the block farther, and that's it. Second is the second strategy, the geometrical strategy is this one. It's the one of Picasso, that used to use the hand as a medium that relate our brain with the physical medium. And I think that has always, especially modernism, but also in these last decades, given a lot of interesting results. And I'm not against this, and in fact I think doodles are really interesting, and if they are not just a stupid gesture, if you are able to interpret them. This is a kind of doodle prototype that I call it Frankenstein, because it's made of a combination of two wonderful buildings of one of my masters in Madrid, UIC. It begins like an office tower, Banco de Bilbao, and changes into a kind of marina tower, the Torres Blancas, which is a kind of replica made at the same time in Madrid and here in have a very dear friend knows very well, and everyone going to Madrid knows well because it's in the way to the city from the airport. So what if we could combine these two things into something that, that grows in complexity as this was this scheme that had no commission at all. It was just an invention, a moment of inspiration. If you are alone, you can say after duty inspiration. Immediately gave way to a project that was another commission in Paris. In this case was a commission of the mayor to give the people of Paris ideas of interest in living paid instead of living postman. So they have a complete lack of spaces. They need to create more spaces, more single units. And the only thing they could imagine is to make proposals by architects that could modify the kind of connotations that high-rise buildings have in Paris. The place was really interesting. It's the periphery. These are, I mean, the topography is very clear, Montmartre, Midsommar, and this is the Roman trace from Notre Dame to Saint-Denis. So it's now physically it's a complex, surrounded by a lot of infrastructures, a complex neighborhood, but in terms of its potentials, it was for us quite interesting. And in fact, for us was immediately, we recognized that we couldn't make a conventional tower, that we had to invent a topography, we had to make things that could be seen ambiguously, in order to not to become a provocation for the Parisian people. And this is what we, and you will see the similarity with something that you know well in the city. We decided to go for this hybrid of a hill and some coupons, some domes, which is Montmartre, and with the same pace and a mixed use program, and create a topography like this. Beginning with this rows, and this is made at the same time Gina was making here the design of the Eiffel Tower, and this was the idea was to make soft transitions, so the whole thing instead of becoming like the first rowing could become a kind of smooth continuous change into more complex shapes, and in fact the idea was to move from the compact to the bundle of towers. As you lift up the section. And we were experimenting with models the limits of this pregnant object, which limit it could become bizarre or elegant. And also we introduced programming again. It was made with a lot of, I mean, it seems it hasn't been made like in one weekend. It obliged us to have a lot of meetings with sociologists, the people that were making the master plan of Paris, and so on. We discovered that they were initially they were imagining this site as a campus. So this was where we immediately took the idea and said it's fantastic to have a kind of iconic figure for a site that no one sees now, to give a kind of physical presence, and also to have young people as a material of construction living. Giving life around, so we decided to make the first part of the section like a vertical campus, and then lofts and residential units. This was our homage to Carla Bruni and Sarkozy in those moments, giving a lot of story. And this is the master plan, which includes a lot of much more simple social housing. Cheap, well-oriented, I mean, rational, but pivoting around this figure. This is a rotation of this person, the drawing, that gives you the potentials of this. And the section, with from the most conventional car park to international center of I don't know what, ready to be campus and so on, and then hotels or residential area for students, and then this is the more private, the beautiful lofts or whatever that are private and that pay partially the whole infrastructure. The layout is very, layout is very basic, and you see in this image to the right, this central area basically has the triple or double cave program, and it's surrounded by a ring of different activities. And on both sides we have the course. Huh? And the materiality is just, in this area, we use parapets in order to give physical, from far away, the presence, the vision of these movements. Here, Gina has used railings, and like Bertra Boller. Well, it doesn't need too much explanation. It began to be something serious that the crisis in destroyed one moment. This is the Romanesque. This is without drawing in the hill of Montmartre. Kind of typical section. And a total view of this three-dimensional topographic ambiguous particle scale. A version of a little version built is of this idea was used in a competition we won for a commercial, little commercial building in Madrid, and our thesis was that this was not needed anymore, that architecture was able to produce meaning in the level of a highway, which is a very romantic idea. But for us it was very clear that in this side, surrounded by a little park and surrounded by this loop, the incredible loop of the highway, we had to make something that could establish a dialogue that could be with high speed. And it was a simple scheme, a very simple scheme, a very conventional one, transformed the form, rotated in order to create a kind of thing that goes within your movement and creates a different space of work, a space that is a landscape in itself and relates into the ministerium and blurs all the bureaucratic stuff, rigid grids and fluorescence and all this stuff that I did, and it establishes a kind of neutral interior design. This is the result with an attic or a penthouse for, with a special height to give it a kind of immediate image from the distance. It's made with rules. So it has a minimum. Everything is made with the maximum size of this or that, or the minimum size of the parapet in order to avoid fire, so in order to protect fire, the structure, etc. This was the render and this is the construction. It has triple, I mean, in this case it had no sense at all to try to have a kind of easy relationship with the steel. It's a triple tower glass, and it's ventilated mechanically at night, so it is resected mechanically. We also have hidden machinery in folding the glass slab, so you don't have kind of hack. And then also we are using water to produce reflections and to produce more than to produce a kind of adiabatic process. It's just a kind of fundamental thing. To produce, because all the project obviously goes about is a kind of narcissistic reflections and reflections over reflections. And this kind of materiality that is almost evanescent and replicates the marble in the entrance. And mirrors again that extend limits of our, but at the same time you see that there is, I mean, it's the simplest floor ceiling. The only thing we have that can be a little bit more expensive is the carbon glass. The new technologies, digital technologies, have changed dramatically its price. So it's only 15% more expensive than the flat one, and this is what is the only unit that this is different. This is the space we have. I mean, the rising floor work has not finished. This is just added to this team. Last lecture I saw this image, the only question I had is, where was the photographer? So the green stuff extends the existing and it tries to establish a kind of continuity among the private and the public surrounding. Well, let's go for the triangular, let's say, instead of the idea, what we have called romantic emotion. The idea that the translator of our interest in vertical escapes and meeting points among nature and architecture and environment can be made through this, what we call romantic emotion, no? this aim to climb up, you know, to establish a kind of almost erotic relationship with mountains, so typically German, but at the same time has a second phase, which is the analytical one. They immediately come back home and study geomorphically mountains and so on. So the idea that this presence of mountains has an internal logic. And it was used extensively in this parade we won, which is under construction at this moment, in a little city of Spain, La Rioja, where the wines of La Rioja are produced. It's a high-speed train competition. The city was previously passed through by the train in Raffle, in the surface, dividing completely the south and the north. And once we were invited to the competition, we understood that it had a political dimension, and the idea that changing the, you know, putting the infrastructure subterranean had an impact in the connectivity, establishing a kind of green belt, establishing a kind of connectivity, you know, also in this direction, but also in this other. So the area that was designated to station for us was primordial to maintain the continuity of the green belt, and this gave us the success to win. This is basically it's a little city, but it's a very interesting city. So we just expanded and made it a kind of like a little hill, so to say, that we gave continuity to the also not only train but bus extension. This is the drawing from the competition. So the thing is, the rest of the program was divided into something that tried to connect the south thing in a kind of regular way, and creating here in the north a more dramatic, so to say, two-dimensional sense for this intervention. They are going to be the tallest buildings in their 22, 23 floors, or so, if not that much. This is the actual state of the process and the construction. And so the station has changed. Well, a lot of things have changed, but basically the area is exactly the same, and I think that it has won these years of discussion. Well, let me go quicker with this. This is how we explain this. The whole intervention is a project that tries to deal with the urban dimension, at the same time with energy means, and also with accessibility. But especially, I can resume it, is that we were interested in creating physically something that could be understood as a new human new human fabric, able to produce a good combination among different technologies. The extensive one, the intensive one, the love for buildings, if you want, but also towers that are understood as vertical parks, some energy means on the top. Well, it's very simple. It's piloting extensions. Here you see them. And then this image probably gives a better understanding of what we call a kind of new spatial, that gives visibility to the idea that environmental issues are not just just bureaucratic or rhetorical, but can give way to different things. And also, this is my all the skills I have to produce models. I'm very bad with my hands, but this gave way to the whole concept of the train and bus station, which was, instead of having domes that are really expensive and complex, we had to make like so many, when we made models of topographies or whatever, triangular, flat, big surfaces that create a kind of brunotout-like cavern or grotto, which these SketchUp drawings show. And then we have columns where we can have them because the tracks go in one way or another. So we have to have every 15-18 meters span some columns that the columns are integrated in this grotto-like shape. These are real drawings of the real definition of the project. And well, this is the train station. Here you see the columns here and there, trying to obtain the best spatial organization in economical terms and also in terms of function. And it gives way to a double skin, up and down surface with this triangular shape. That for us is an extension of the public dimension, such like a landscape park, it has its own purpose. And the landscape and the architecture are developed in this, I would say, this mood. So this is the station. Still very simple values. The scale of details. This is the landscape. I don't know if you are going to see something. Managing water and with this triangular pattern, we are creating a kind of similarity with the different plants that you see in the hills surrounding the city. To this. Again, believe me, these are the best plants for the site. And these are the patterns that are created and the systems of that regulate the regime of water. But this can be, it's not the best that I've seen. And we, as the engineers allow us for a very little pay, we had to pump up the skylines and create a kind of areas with natural light. And then they give way to these other spaces. And this is the total effect. We wanted to create a kind of unique system, so all of the systems with different geometries are combined and create a kind of bigger scale than the small scale of each element by itself. This is being, here are some photographs on the back, the construction. Maybe this was made 1 month ago. Another triangular thing in Turin. I'm going to, if you want, I stop one wherever you want me to stop. This is in Turin. One of the two, one of the three skyscrapers they want to construct. One is Renata Sentkiewicz, other is. This was a competition among three architects. It was like a job, a German, French, and Spanish. And the thing is that Torino is a wonderful flat land that once you go up, you see incredibly well the Alps, and you have this reference of Mole Antoliniana, a synagogue. So what we produce, I mean, it was a hybrid program, and I think the main thing is how the use of geometry is giving way to different perceptions of what we call vertical scales and different energy means. In this case, we created a kind of synergy of three different parts of the program. We say it's like the Giro d'Italia, a mountain in different different mountains combined. The valleys separate, basically, programs, but they together combine it to create a kind of unique thing that responds to the neatness of in the edge, very Italian in this case, the highest point, 100 meters high, but instead of looking frontally, it looks to the Alps, so it works with ambiguity, this kind of monumentality. Structurally, technically, it's completely appropriate to use this triangulation, and programmatically, it's also very easy to deal with different programs, official, commercial, residential. Also give some flexibility because they can, in one moment, they can be linked. You know? So in this sense, then there's the question of orientation. Those that need light from the north are protected, and protect those that require light from the south. So they create a kind of synergy. Also, those triangles that are more exposed to radiation are filled with photovoltaic panels, so triple glass ventilated, and silk springs with dots wrapping the glass, so it's always snowing in the proximity of this building, and it's always looking to the glass. Let me go to. Yes, I want to go to this. I'll finish with this. The last combination of geometries is the still life thing, is the possibility of dealing with all pre-existing fabrics or different programs or natural and artificial elements, and the still life metaphor, if you want, is clearly interesting in these cases. So you produce entities that are hybrid, combination of pre-existing, natural, artificial, creating like totalities or entities that can be understood as unique things. And this has been, every time we had complex programs or we had to deal with restoration or renovation has come to our minds as a technique to design. In this case, it was the first museum we have completed in Barcelona. This is La Pedrera, the famous Gaudí house, and this is Paseo de Gracia, and I don't know where it is. It was a historical building, one of the first modernist industrial buildings to be constructed in the example of Cerda, which was the main idea of Cerda, was the incorporation of life and work at the same time in this matrix. So this was a structure that had been renovated 30 years ago with postmodernist criteria, but with a beautiful intervention by Tony Tapies, the Catalan artist, still alive. This is the original printer with paper and very good books produced in this printing company, and with a lot of Masonic stuff. And this was what we inherited. Stairs that were like going this way and the other, strange stuff that no one liked and that had a lot of problems with regulations. I mean, a lot of people liked it a lot in the 70s when it was in the main. So, the life of these things is very short, obviously. And the fact is that the interior, the life of the courtyard, which is one of the key elements of the federal plan. It's still terrible, but the relationship that this had been like a kind of black hole there was really difficult. So for us, we had to deal with a renovation that had to transform stairs to protect against fire, I mean, all types of different things. And we began just with a little stair, in fact with this one, and it came a moment where everything was so expensive that we said, let's take this opportunity to make something really interesting. And it took us like 1 year to obtain the approval, but finally everyone agreed that it was logical. The logical thing was the modernist building integrally transformed into a public infrastructure. So it's a museum where you have archives, educational program, a lot of things that were impossible to offer to the public previously. And then we just extend the construction with this little, very little thing that reaches the level of the patio and that give way to the most administrative thing. But doing so, we also created a kind of much more complex experience for the visitor, because every element of the program could be seen and could be activated. So you didn't only see you don't really see exclusively the rooms where the artists are exhibiting, but you see the whole process, the whole educational library or office space, etc. And I think this integration is quite interesting. Also, the fact that we have reduced the surface with the exterior has allowed us to not to change any machine. So energetically, it works with another 1,000 square meters, exactly with the same kind of machines and energy consumption previously. So in a very simple way, it has less relationship with the exterior, and we have protected the relationship of the historical fabric, so it works much better. These are the also, we wanted to, even if this is interesting, some of the extensions that were made in this post-modernist period, without changing them, we wanted to hidden this. So we have introduced a kind of textile that introduces natural light but avoids you to see the postmodern stuff. Well, here you see it's very well. And we have a little terrace that invited Anthony Tapis to make another intervention, and he agreed finally, so it has been interesting, this experience. And you see, I mean, the layout really, I mean, it's very simple, the cast iron structure. It's a really, really a lot of space made in Barcelona, and our extension is very mimetic in the sense that it replicates with our technology, but it was already there. We are transforming the, you see, it's like an advertisement. Before and after. And here we had rigid walls with this is the air, this kind of historical thing is the air conditioning ducts and so on. So we have given this hypostylar room all its extension. We have changed the way the columns were protected against torsion into something more, well, here you still see it. You don't see it. And this is what I mean. We have changed a little bit the artificial light, but it's not that important. Here you see the result is kind of neutral wood deck. It comes from the typical wood pavement of these industrial buildings. So, but it changes the noise and the of color, it changes a lot of things without being dramatic. Almost invisible. The natural light comes in, this is what I say, you don't see anything, it's like a cubic suspended cloud. There is no materiality, but the effect is that you only see what you want to see. And you have natural light in the library, beautiful area of the library. This is what I say. And this is the new. That the transition, obviously the white thing always equilibrates everything, the transition is really smooth and seems to be a kind of similar thing. I mean, this, we had no money for all the things that showing everything and painting it well. But sometimes, I mean, like this one with the reflection of the library, sometimes it's okay to have to deal with these kind of puzzles. We have also a new relation to the visibility of the patio and the manzana, the interior courtyard. Again, we replicate the same idea than in in order to think, because we were limited by regulations, we couldn't make it bigger, so we said, okay, we hidden the stair in order to create these grades and extend the dimension, horizontal dimension of the room and the mirror. And this gives way to the terrace that protects the views from the exterior and creates this shock, which is a very well known in Barcelona project for the Museum of Catalan Art that gave way to a lot of polemics with the Catholic Church and the authorities. It was when democracy came to Spain. It was not in terms of fact. And then finally it was suspended. So at the end of his life, he wanted to have this in his home. Thank you very much.
I'm not interested in this kind of competition at all. I think many are not interested in this kind of Harry Reese, for example, was not interested in this kind of competition at all. But I think that maintaining the idea that every vertical construction is a replication of horizontal legs is for me something that gives me a kind of total transparency to what I'm doing. So, and in fact, if you work in this direction, you find that everything is easy in terms of how to adapt yourself to regulations, how to adapt to the panoramic views, how to adapt to different codes, etc. And in the moment you begin to contrast and to create like vertical lines or things like that, you become involved in compositional problems that I detest. I don't know if this is a good response.
There's an interesting situation going on in contextual responses in many of the work, and yet it's very strong commitment to geometry, however you position it. And there's a sense of a rationality behind it. Interface between geometry and that context. You give us a series of objects that are well documented. The question is, at some point, there is truly a conflict at some point. And it seems that you generally come down on the side of the geometry from the point. And I'm curious, is that part of the grid heritage here, or is it really something that you've chosen, or is it more of an intuitive sense?
Yeah. I don't know. I think that economy is very important. more than the tradition of Madrid school. So in the way I deal with, I would agree with contextual issues that are always important, even if you are not a contextualist, and different geometries. I think that the economical issues clearly drive me to decide one or other way. And depending on the budget, depending on the program, or something, but in many of these, I have always been interested in simplicity, and even in the tower in Paris, the mechanism is like a tower. It's really simple. No? So it's extended cantilever extension. So it's not that there is an effect of complexity that doesn't exist technically, or at least is very reduced. And when I choose, but when I have limited budgets, I always go for straight shapes, I mean simple shapes. When I have a little bit of grief, I begin to explore other fields. So probably it's the hidden agenda is not the arch.uic lab, but the budget, as I said, for everyone. I don't want to be too pragmatic, but this is important, especially working in a country like Spain.
Thank you.